I'm told that. Everybody hear me all right? All right, good deal. Good afternoon, everyone. I want to quickly say thank you to Alabama Forest Owners Association for inviting me to come speak to you guys today. Like you heard in the introduction, I'm going to talk to you about some market realities that we see within the marketplace today, currently, and kind of what we expect to see going forward. Real quickly, I'm going to give you some background on myself. You heard that I'm a client representative of the Forest Market, so I work with customers, a lot of our customers throughout the southeastern U.S. Prior to that, my first role with the company was to manage and oversee our stumpage price database, where I collected and input information into the database and then in turn produced custom and standard analytics off of that database. I've been working there for three and a half years now, and just this past January is when I transitioned into more of the client-facing role side that I do now. And then I want to tell you a little bit about Forest Market in case you guys aren't familiar with us. So at our very core, Forest Market is a data and information services company. What we do is we serve all participants throughout the forest products industry. And how we do that is by collecting price data on raw materials within different points of the supply chain. So we work with small private landowners, large landowners, large consuming mills, consulting foresters, like I said, all participants. So Forest to Market was started back in 2001, and the stumpage price database was our first product. And since then, we've launched several new products. In 2005, we began forecasting pricing off our stumpage database. In 2006, we were approached by a lot of the mills in the southeast to create a delivered price benchmark where we capture prices at the gate, mill gate. That product quickly spread to the Pacific Northwest region. And at that point, we started producing a lot of custom analytics, supply chain services, and resource analysis for a lot of our customers. In 2009, we then launched a lumber report and benchmark. And then after that, you know, the delivered benchmark began to spread even more, where we moved into various regions throughout North America, so the Lake State regions, Northeast U.S., and Canada. Just recently, we began to expand internationally, where we now collect data and produce benchmarks in Brazil, as well as the Baltic states. So our main goal of Forest Market is to empower all participants within the industry and help them make exponentially better decisions when they're involved in the marketplace. And the way that we do this is by collecting real-time transaction data. We don't collect any survey data. All the data that we collect is based off of actual transactions that take place within the marketplace. And we collect this information, again, from all participants involved. Landowners, forest consultants, suppliers, as well as large consuming mills. And obviously, we want to combine these these unique data sets that we collect, combine this with our great operational experience that we have in our executive team, as well as combine it with our great analytics group that we have there in Charlotte, and use all three of those tools to build, all three of those groups to build tools to help our customers understand and operate in the market more efficiently. So I want to kind of go over the stumpage database with you real quickly today to give you an idea of what that is, because a lot of the data that I'm going to show you going forward in the presentation is going to be off of this database. So again, Forest to Market, like I said, we collect transaction-based data in all of our databases, and the stumpage database is no different. When we're talking about the stumpage database, we talk about, you know, transaction data being on a track-by-track basis, and we collect this information on real timber sales that happen between buyers and sellers on a daily basis. And we really think that you know, the database helps our customers in a lot of different ways. Probably the biggest way that it helps them is that they are able to really gain market intelligence or competitive advantage, potentially by being able to access the most up-to-date and current market pricing available online through our website 24/7 a day, at any time of the day, and is also really be able to get an understanding of the true local prices through our custom micro market areas. So not only do we collect price information in our stumpage database, but we also collect a lot of track and sell attributes as well, which kind of helps us when analyzing the data to answer, you know, the how and the why, when a particular sell or price on a track seems to be out of line with what the market is. You can kind of see some of these up here. So we collect information like road access and loggability on the track. We collect seller and buyer type as well as harvest type, sell type. And again, as I mentioned earlier, we collect information at the county level. So you can again get a good idea of what true local pricing is happening in your area. Real quick view of kind of how the database would look. This is a summary result from a query within our database. So you would go in on this page, enter all the different attributes that you kind of want to filter by. Obviously, a specific time period, a specific geographic location, and any of the different track and cell attributes that you might want to focus on. And obviously, when you hit search, then you'll get this immediate summary page where then you'll see the products involved with products and all the sales involved within that time period, the weighted average price per ton, the average log size if it's available. We collect log size on all the chip and saw, saw timber, and coal products, the number of sales that are involved with that, and then also the total tonnage. Now this is the summary page, and then beyond this, you kind of have the ability to dig down into the data and look at individual sales. Just a quick summary of kind of what the database looks like. So again, what I want to talk to you about today is what's going on in the market right now, the trends that we see in the industry, and ultimately, what do we see going forward, and how do we expect that to ultimately affect stumpage pricing. So first, we're going to start with pine pulpwood here. This chart is showing the historic trend of pine pulpwood from 2001 all the way to Q1 2017. And as you can see, pine pulpwood's been jumpy at times, but all in all, there's been a slight steady increase over the last decade or so, a little bit more, 2% annual return over that time period. But you also notice here the last probably couple years, 2 or 3 years, it's been a decline as well. And obviously, we don't want to see it. So we want to answer the question of how the industry is doing. We know where the market is. Current pricing, pulpwood right now is probably right around $8 per ton, somewhere along in there, for the average state of Alabama. So we want to know how the industry is doing. And obviously, if we were just going off of just the stumpage price, and especially the last couple of years and the way it's been trending, the logical assumption would be that it's kind of struggling, it's not doing very well. But that's really not the case. And this slide, while it's a little dated, kind of illustrates that point that I want to make, which is the pulp and paper industry is a growing industry, and it's something that we continue to expect to grow into the future. So this graph is showing the increase or decrease in demand of various pulp and paper grades globally over the last 5 years. So you can see here that there's several grades of pulp and paper products that have seen strong growth over the last 5 years, market pulp, packaging, specialty products, as well as tissue and towel. With printing and writing, I guess technically is in the red, or in black, I mean, but it's really a net. And then newsprint, obviously, is the one loan that's negative, that's been decreasing in demand. This decrease and really no growth is not a real big surprise. This is a trend that we've kind of seen probably over the last decade as society becomes more digitalized and we use less and less paper. But all in all, it's good news for the pulp and paper industry. As you can see, there's growth. There is a little bit of a caveat, I guess, when you look at the global growth of the pulp and paper industry. From our viewpoint, here in the South anyways, and that is that the vast majority of this increase in demand, this growth, is happening overseas where populations have been growing at a rapid rate and expected to continue to grow in places like Asia Pacific, Africa, and the Middle East. There's increases in demand here in the U.S., but they're nowhere near as large as we see in other areas of the world. So when you see all that growth overseas, you expect it's going to create some difficulties for the companies operating here in the U.S. to compete in those overseas markets.
Market pull, is that what?
Yes, sir. Yeah. So then this kind of begs the question of, well, if the industry is doing so well and it's strong, why are pulpwood prices doing what they're doing right now? And And there's a couple different factors that kind of go into that, but really the couple unusual weather we've had the last couple of years were dry, mild winters. Have really had a big effect. It's opened up the supply availability of pulpwood in the state. But also, the continued improvement of housing has really increased the residual chip supply the sawmills produce, which competes directly with pulpwood. So it's kind of putting some downward pressure on pulpwood prices right now. So moving on to logs, chip and saw timber. Obviously, I'm pretty sure most people in here have probably seen this graph a couple of times, and it's not really easy to look at. It's tough to see. You know, you see everything's kind of really good mid-2000s, and then 2007 comes, and the bottom kind of drops out of it, and prices plummet. And you can see, you know, 37.5% drop over that time period. Luckily, it looks like in 2012 we kind of hit the bottom. There's been some ups and downs since that time period, but all in all, chip and saw has kind of held its ground since then, so that's good. And then saw timber is the same story again. Really good here in the mid-2000s, 2007 comes, drops even further than chip and saw, 49% drop over there. And then again, right around 2011, 2012, it appears to have hit the bottom, but we're still seeing some declines over that time period. So even though it's not dropping as fast as it was, we're still seeing some drops in the price of saw timber. And right now, currently, it's on average somewhere around the $25 per ton range. So just like the pulp and paper question, you know, if you're asking the question how the industry is doing, and you're judging it based solely on the stumpage pricing, what we've seen in the last, say, 5, 6, 7 years, the logical assumption is to say, well, the lumber industry must be really struggling because our stumpage prices are struggling. And again, it's not the case. The lumber industry continues to rebound from the recession. It's been strong as of late. Softwood lumber production has steadily increased over the last few years. As a matter of fact, in 2016, the numbers just came out not too long ago. The Southeast produced just over 17 billion board feet in lumber. And again, like I said, that's increased steadily the last couple of years. Lumber prices are reflecting this, as you can see from our Lumber Weekly report. This is probably a week, maybe 2 weeks old, but this is the composite lumber price for dimension lumber. And in this graph a couple weeks ago, it was sitting at $420 per thousand. And if I'm not mistaken, it's actually went up since then. So again, lumber prices are strong. And this is really driven by the housing market that continues to improve. Improve is a relative term because it's not improving at the pace we would like it to, but it is still improving. And let me go back. So I guess that begs the question again. The industry's doing well, it's strong. Lumber's going good. Sawmills are producing more and more lumber every year. Demand for saw timber is increasing, but pricing is still being dampened, declining. And so why is this happening? And again, this is probably a story that you guys have heard several times, but I think it still holds true and it's still an important factor in the stumpage price for saw timber. And as you can see from this chart, so this chart represents pine acreage by age class in the U.S. South. So total acreage, and then you have the different age classes here. And this line here represents the age class of 21 to 40 years of age, so where the vast majority of saw timber is going to fall into. And you can see since 2007, the percent volume has steadily increased since then. And obviously we know that, you know, as that acreage continues to grow, that supply continues to grow, all it's going to do is continue to put down the pressure on pricing, how much saw timber is available. And kind of this started with the recession, and it's lingered probably longer than it should have because of the housing market. Like I said, it's been improving, but it hasn't been improving at the pace we think it should have or should be. Or really, it hasn't been improving at the pace it should be. And this is really due to the millennial generation. Millennials are now the largest demographic in the U.S., roughly 92 million people between the ages of 15 and 35. And they are A lot of them are in this peak home buying year, 25 to 45 years of age. But a lot of them are still on the sidelines in the housing market, so they have yet to enter the housing market, buy a home, build a home, things like that. And there's several reasons behind this that I'm going to kind of walk through. One reason is marriage. The millennial generation has pushed back marriage basically 7 years since their parents. So in 1970, the average age to get married was 23 years old. 2010, that's bumped up to 30. And then if we think about this in kind of big life steps, marriage is probably one of the big first life steps that you take. And once you get married, you build a house. So obviously, they're waiting longer to get married, which means they're waiting longer to build a house, to buy a house. And then also, combined with that, not only are they waiting longer, but even when they do get married, they're getting married and then owning a home at a lower rate than their parents as well. So again, you can see 1968, 56% of people that were married owned a home. And then now in 2012, it was 23%. The main factor behind this is because millennials are more urban centric, and we kind of know this. I think I heard somebody touch on this earlier today, that everybody kind of wants to live in cities now. They like the convenience of having everything right there at their fingertips, and being in a city for the most part means that you're going to live in an apartment, multi-family housing. But there is some good news, there's some hope, because of research that's taking place. We know that a large percent of millennials still wants to own their own home. It's just a matter of financials. Either they haven't reached the stage to get there yet, or the financials just don't make sense at this point. And that's because of a lot of the economy. 40% of them only work full time, which really hinders their ability to save up for a down payment. And then obviously, we all know the student loan, we've heard the student loan debt. The average student loan debt is $33,000. In America. So this underemployment combined with a large student loan debt has really kept the millennials kind of off on the sidelines and not allowed them to really enter the housing market at the pace they typically should have.
This is very small.
So that's kind of the current state with where the market is as far as stumpage prices go and how the industry is health-wise. So then that kind of ask the question now is, all right, well, what do we expect going forward? And how are these industry trends going to affect the stumpage prices in the short and the long term? So it's a little bit of a mixed bag behind Oakwood. In the short term, we don't really see much relief in the pricing that we have currently for pine Oakwood, and that's really due to the same factors that we talked about. There's kind of a glut in the market right now for pine pulpwood, and it's also competing with the increase in residual chip availability. But the long term, I kind of hinted at this earlier, global demand is good and it's growing, so that's a good thing. And there's some possibility of a supply constraint down the road, which I'll talk a little bit more about just in a second. So if you think back to that slide where it showed the breakout of the pulp and paper grades, where pulp, packaging, and tissue and towel are kind of the big three that had the largest increase in demand. There are those that we expect to see large increases in the future. When you think about this in terms of how the U.S. South companies have positioned themselves, they align very nicely with those markets that we expect to see future growth in. And this is outlined by this chart here. So this chart is showing wood fiber consumption by mill type. So you'll see 68% of the total wood fiber consumption is going to market, to companies that produce market pulp, and then 20% is going to mills that produce packaging. So this is a good thing. I'm going to repeat this because I think it's worth noting that all that demand that we talked about is happening overseas. So these companies operating in the South are going to be in good markets, but unfortunately, they're going to have to start competing to sell their product overseas. And again, that's going to create some difficulties for them. And just to kind of give you an example, the best one that I can think of is exchange rates. The U.S. dollar has been strong. It's been strong for a while, actually. And when those companies begin to try and sell those products in the overseas markets, it puts them at an automatic disadvantage when the dollar is strong like that. But all in all, it's good news for the pulp and paper market. And it's something that, you know, it's something to look forward to be optimistic about long-term for that injury and for Pine Bowl. The other factor that I mentioned, the possible supply constraint that we potentially see in the future, just put it out there right now, I don't think it's a big concern, but it's something to keep an eye on. So this is the same chart that I showed earlier with saw timber, but now we're looking at the lower age class material. So as you can see, this line is showing the age class 0 to 10. So maybe not necessarily pulpwood size material yet, but it's something that will grow into pulpwood size material. And that age class has been declining in total acreage of volume over the last several years. So again, as we kind of all know right now, it's not a big factor. As we've got too much supply of pine pulpwood right now, but if this trend continues, it's something that could have a big effect on pulpwood prices in the future. Chip and saw and saw timber kind of follow the same mode. Again, as pine pulpwood, you know, it's the short term, we don't see a whole lot of change. Chip and saw is probably a little bit better outlook because it gets pressure from both the pulp mills as well as the sawmills. So a lot of sawmills have kind of set their mill up to run these smaller size logs better. So they might be a little bit more pursued than a larger size tree. And also, you know, when we think about the supply constraints on the pulpwood side we just talked about, if that continues, these pulp mills will then be pushed to push up into this chip and saw product class, buy that as pulpwood to feed their mills. This is actually something that we've seen a little bit of already in the South Georgia area, North Florida, where a lot of the pulp mills have come in and really increased the demand for that pulpwood size material. Saw timber, again, is kind of the same thing. The short term, we don't see a whole lot of movement in saw timber based on the same thing we talked about. You know, you've got that oversupply. We need something to happen where we can take a big chunk out of that oversupply before we can really have any effect on saw timber. But like we said, we know that housing is improving slowly but steadily, and we also, you know, have the knowledge about the millennial generation and how they feel about home buying, home owning. So there's a brighter future ahead, and I want to elaborate just real quickly on that to kind of give you not just an engine with what we think is going to be good in the future, kind of give you a good idea of what we think. So this is a model that Forest Market built a few years back. And what you're looking at is single family home starts actual, and then this is single family home starts based on what the model would predict would happen in the marketplace based on some macroeconomic variables such as population growth and GDP. So you can see during the boom, we actually were building, you know, 1.2, 1.3 million starts per year, when the model was predicting we should be around 800,000 or 900,000 per year. So we were overbuilding then. As we all know now, in 2007, we had the crash. And then coming out of the recession, the single family home starts stayed really depressed because of those. A lot of millennials obviously didn't enter the market after that. And a lot of people who could have entered the market did enter it because of financial reasons as well. And the model is predicting that we should be back up fairly quickly around the 800,000 to 900,000 starts per year. So we're currently now underbuilding single family homes. So just like in 2007, when the market corrected itself, you know, we expect the market to correct itself here as well. So this is our housing forecast, which ultimately is gonna drive this lumber market and then trickle down to the stumpage as well. So the next few years, probably 6 to 8 years, you know, we expect again that slow, steady climb to increase. And then right around the year 2024, I guess somewhere along in there, that's when we expect to see the millennial generation kind of come out off the sidelines and really come into the housing market. And you're going to see a surge of starts for that 3 or 4 year period, average around 1.8 million starts. And then after that surge comes, then we'll settle back down and hover around a historical 1.5 million starts per year average. And we expect this to really eat into that oversupply of saw timber and then ultimately apply some upward pressure on saw timber prices. So to summarize really quickly, you know, while stumpage prices aren't exactly where we want them to be at the moment, The industries, both pulp and paper and lumber, are strong and doing well, so that's something to be positive about. And while the short term, there's not much relief in sight, you know, we think that the factors are, I don't want to say the stars are aligning, but things are getting better, and in the long term, we expect things to improve dramatically, especially in the terms of office. So with that, I'm going to end and say thank you, and obviously take questions to that.